Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. My name is Pastor Ed, and you are joining Bridgepoint Community's Wednesday online Bible study. We welcome you. Some of you I can see are joining us on Zoom, and the rest of you are probably watching us on Facebook Live, or maybe even a recording of this lesson on YouTube or from our website. However you are joining us, we are so glad that you've made Bridgepoint and our Bible study a part of what you are doing at this moment. So can I invite you to join me in a word of prayer as we begin our study for this evening? Our Father in heaven, our hearts are full of joy and thanksgiving. In spite of how difficult our week might have been, or even with the blessings that we have received, we always find good reason to give you thanks. And today we thank you for health and strength, for energy, for the motivation to be in this place, to study your word. Our bodies might be weak, but our spirits are always willing to learn. And so would you grant to us everything we need to fulfill your will in our lives in this moment? We thank you in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen and amen. All right, let's get straight to the study before we do anything else. And just to update you on what's going on in case you are just joining us right now, we are in the middle of a series that we have entitled, What Do the Scriptures Say? We are investigating major themes from the Bible, and every now and then we'll actually delve into even sub-themes that have to do with some of the topics that we cover, and today will be one example. So, for instance, last week, we talked about the theme of prayer, and we ask ourselves the question, what do the scriptures say about prayer? And so, you know, prayer is such a big topic. We barely scratched the surface, but at least we were able to deal with some of the basic biblical teachings about prayer, how to put it into practice, giving you hopefully some very real world adaptable pieces of advice that you've been able to incorporate into your daily life. Well, what I want to do tonight is to actually kind of bounce off one of the elements of the issue of prayer that we talked about. And today I'd like to ask the question, what does scripture say about vengeance? Now you might ask yourself, what does vengeance have to do with prayer? Well, remember when we talked about prayer, one of the things we covered both in our Wednesday Bible study last week and even in a previous sermon that I preached just a few weeks prior, we looked into what we traditionally call the Lord's Prayer. And in the Lord's Prayer, among the things that Jesus told us to pray are, you know, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We call that one of the more difficult aspects of the prayer to really be serious about. But then there's another part of that prayer that I found actually quite difficult. And it's the part that says, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And then later on, as a footnote to the prayer, Matthew goes on to say that, you know, if you are not forgiving towards others, then why will the Lord be forgiving towards you? Because we are asking God to forgive us to the measure that we are willing to be forgiving towards others. And what makes forgiveness so difficult? And I think it's this. I think is that when it comes to dealing with hurt and hardship and maybe pain that's been inflicted on us, our initial response is normally not prayer. Neither is it forgiveness. I find in my own experience and in many people's lives that the first instinct we have when we are hurt is to hurt people back. And that's where we get the concept of vengeance, right? An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. And how does God deal with that in our lives? How did Jesus, knowing that tendency, teach us to behave otherwise? Well, there's many passages we can look at, but I want to focus today on an event leading to a parable that we find in Matthew chapter 18. So let me just read to you the beginning, the first two verses leading to the parable that we will study in a few moments. In Matthew 18, 20 and 21, this is what we read. Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, How often should I forgive someone who sins against me? 7 times? No, not 7 times, Jesus replied, but 70 times 7. Jesus almost answers in a mathematical, riddle. You know, he doesn't give a specific number in terms of this is the only amount of forgiveness you should give, but he's using it as a figure of speech, 70 times 7 times. You know, what does that mean? Should we do the math and whatever answer we get, that's the only amount of times that we are to forgive people? Well, let's look into that and try to understand what is going on here. As a way of introduction, I think we can relate to this question that Peter asked for several reasons. Number one is, it's easiest for us to think of all the people that have hurt us in our lifetime. You know, think of maybe the harsh way you might have been parented by your dad or your mom. Maybe something a teacher said when you were young that really hurt your feelings. Something a classmate said, or something that a close friend might have done that you felt betrayed. And as you grow older, these hurts become more painful, more pronounced. You know, maybe somebody broke your heart when you gave it to them so willingly and so freely. Maybe somebody stabbed your back, so to speak, in a business dealing. Maybe you were mistreated at work. Maybe you were in a relationship that went sour. You know, there are many things that can happen in a person's lifetime that will remind us that life is full of painful moments. And so we bring to mind people who have hurt us. But we also have to think, secondly, that not only is it true that in everyone's life, people hurt us, but I also want you to think of the people that you may have hurt in your lifetime. Were you a difficult child? Were you disobedient to your parents? Did you break their heart with some of the decisions that you made? Were you unruly, you know, as a student? Did you make life difficult for people around you? Were you the one who betrayed your friend? Were you the one who broke someone's heart when they gave it so freely to you? Did you take advantage of people and use them to your own advantage? So how many times have you been the cause of people's hurt? That's not something we sometimes ponder as much as the hurt that people cause us, but it's an equally important question. And then the third question is the one that I think Jesus really wants us to think about. And the third question is, what kind of a world will it be if you and I, who hurt each other, still refuse to forgive and only want to continue with vengeance? The answer, of course, is very easy, because all we have to do is look around us. We live in a world where people are pursuing vengeful emotions, vengeful feelings. Look at wars that are taking place in the world right now. Look at the discord in relationships that are taking place, marriages that are falling apart, relationships with parents and children that aren't working out. You know, a lot of this is born out of an unwillingness to forgive, an unwillingness to own up to our faults and to say, what have I done to aggravate the situation, and I need to ask for forgiveness as much as I need to be willing to forgive. And this is at the heart of what Jesus is about to do in dealing with Peter. So with that in mind, let's kind of go back to Peter's question. And I want to focus on what might have motivated him to ask this question. Think about it this way. When Jesus answered him, you must forgive 70 times 7 times, you know, 490 if you want to be precise. More important than the answer of Jesus is, in my mind, why did Peter even ask the question to begin with? You know, the story says Peter came to Jesus and asked the question. So something must have happened to Peter that prompted him to ask Jesus for this advice. You know, it could have been an issue that he's been dealing with for a long time. Maybe he was having a business dispute in the fishing industry. Who knows? Maybe he just had a quarrel with his wife. Maybe he was not getting along with his mother-in-law. Maybe he just fought with one of the apostles. I don't know. You know, we don't know what prompted him to ask this question. It might have been a long-term issue. It might have just happened moments before he asked the question. Nonetheless, he did end up being the one who came to Jesus with the questions. Jesus didn't ask him anything. It was Peter who initiated the discussion. Clearly, there was something in Peter's heart, in his mind, that he wanted to get out off his chest. He wanted this burden to be released. And one of the ways he tried to pacify himself was to say, okay, if someone has offended me, Jesus, how many times should I forgive? How many times am I allowed to forgive? And then after that, say, I've done my part. I've forgiven as much as I could. I'm clean. You know, Peter was looking for a quota. He was looking for a limit to how far we should be allowed to forgive. But there's also an underlying assumption in his question, and it's this. Peter's question assumed that he was a victim of an offense, and that may be true. However, his question failed to acknowledge that he could also be a cause of an offense, either in the case that he's thinking of or in some other case. So in other words, whether it was legitimate or not, that someone had legitimately truly hurt him, that he was pondering the issue of forgiveness, it was still not enough, because even in the middle of all of that, you still have to acknowledge that although, yes, you have been hurt, don't forget that you have also in the past and maybe in the present been the cause of other people's hurt, so you're not exactly off the hook. The question seems to assume that the offense is being done to Peter, but he has no obligation to own up to any offense that he might have caused to others. So Jesus wanted him to be mindful that this is a bigger issue than what Peter is thinking. So in order to answer Peter's question, Jesus, in typical rabbinic fashion, tells Peter a story, a parable. It's probably not a true story, but it could be based on a true story. But the point is, the story is told to end with a moral lesson, something to think about. So let me read the story to you. It is found in Matthew chapter 18, starting with verse 23, you know, shortly after Jesus and Peter had this exchange with a question. And here's the story. It says, "Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 bags of gold was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. At this, the servant fell on his knees before him. 'Be patient with me,' said the servant, 'and I will pay you back everything.' The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and then let him go. But then the servant went out, found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 silver coins. He grabbed him, began to choke him, and said, 'Pay back what you owe me.' This he demanded. His fellow servant fell on his knees and begged him, 'Be patient with me, and I will pay you back.' But the other servant refused. Instead, he went off, had the man thrown into prison until he could pay back the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were outraged and went and told their master everything that had happened. So the master called the servant in. 'You wicked servant,' he said. 'I canceled all the debts of yours because you simply begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had mercy on you?' In anger, his master handed him over to the jailers to be tortured until he should pay back what he owed." And then Jesus ends with this lesson. "This is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart." It's a very, very harsh lesson. In fact, the way Jesus ended the lesson is very harsh as well. You know, he said, "This is how the Father will treat you." This is what he will do to you. He will not show you mercy if you are the kind of person that does not know how to show mercy. Now think about the gravity of what Jesus is sharing here. The story is actually well known and told many times over. You know, you have a servant who has been forgiven of a great debt. In fact, it says in one of the verses that what he owed his master was 10,000 bags of gold. I'm honestly not sure how much that is in U.S. dollars today, but I guarantee you it's a lot of money. 10,000 bags of gold is probably the equivalent of tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands, maybe even millions of dollars by today's currency. In other words, you know, for exaggerated effect, Jesus is saying that this servant owed his master an exorbitant amount such that he, in his lifetime, could never pay it back. That's why when he begged his master, "Forgive me, give me time, I will pay it back," he knew he would never be able to pay it back. But more importantly, even the master knew that if the servant worked overtime many times over his lifetime, he still would not be able to pay this debt. His only hope was mercy. And that's what the master did. The master said, "You know what? I'm going to erase your debt. I'm going to act as if it never happened. I will forgive it so that you can be released from this obligation." It should have been the end of the story. But as we learned, that same guy who was forgiven found another fellow servant who owed him, in this case, a few pieces of silver. It's told in the story that way so that you can contrast the bags and bags of gold compared to a few pieces of silver. If the man was forgiven of the debt of bags of gold, should he not be able to, or should be able to, be more forgiving of a smaller debt? But this is not what happened. The unmerciful servant demanded payment from the other servant, and when he could not, and even after begging, just as he did a few moments ago, threw the guy in jail for the offense. And of course, the master heard about it through other means, and then took back, you know, the decision. He said, "Because you were not forgiving, I will then take back the mercy that I had so freely given you, and I will demand that you pay for the penalty of not paying me back my debt." Again, it's probably not a true story. It may have happened in one form or another, but in the case that Jesus is telling, it's a made-up story. It's a parable. It has exaggerated elements, but it's for effect. It's for teaching effect, because Jesus wanted Peter to learn something very important. Peter was looking for the minimum activity, the minimum commitment to get away with his obligation to forgive, whereas Jesus was giving him a maximum, room for grace, room for people to ask for mercy and be given it. And he wanted Peter to have not the heart of a stingy forgiver, but someone who was very generous and elaborate and liberal with how he would give to others. And so hopefully Peter learned his lesson and walked away from that wiser than when he began. Well, what about us? What lessons can we learn as a result of this parable, plus other things that scriptures say about that? You know, it's interesting when the reformer Martin Luther once wrote about this parable. You know, he preached a sermon based on Matthew 18, and then he wrote it in one of his journals that became a published work. This is how Martin Luther kind of summarized his thoughts on this parable. He said, "Should we then bite and scratch each other like dogs and cats? No, but we should heartily forgive and ask, 'Why should I accuse my brother? If God is merciful unto me, and for the sake of his son, Jesus Christ, forgives me so great a debt, why should I make so much ado about a penny or two? I will call it square, forgive and forget, and thank God that he has forgiven me and made me a partaker of his grace.'" You know, it's interesting that Martin Luther says this, because if you know anything about Martin Luther, for all his virtues and for all his contributions to Christianity, and especially Reformed Christianity, Martin Luther was known to also be a man of ill temper. Many people who knew him testify that Martin Luther had anger issues. He had anger management issues. In fact, many of the people, including his wife, would often say the older he got, the crankier he became. You know, the older he got, the more difficult he was to deal with. So it's interesting that Martin Luther is sharing these thoughts, but he himself, I think, is preaching to his own spirit. He's reminding himself about his own tendencies to fight back, to be vengeful when people hurt him. And it's almost like he's preaching, but he's preaching to himself when he says, you know what, if God was merciful towards me for a big offense, am I not willing to be merciful for smaller offenses that are done against me? So I think this is a lesson that Martin Luther played in his head over and over, even as he grew older, you know, and I imagine it's something we need to do ourselves. Well, what about the Apostle Paul? What did he learn from this? And how did he pass on the wisdom after being so forgiven by a God that he had defied prior to his conversion? Let's look at what Paul said in the book of Romans chapter 12, when he gives the Romans instructions on how to deal with hurt and the instinct to be vengeful against those who have hurt you. He says three things to begin with in chapter 12. Number one, he says, bless those who persecute you. Don't curse them. Pray that God will bless them. Wow. You know, Paul himself was a persecutor, and he was glad for the people that forgave him, for the people that were able to receive him as a brother in the faith, even though his past and his history was very questionable. And so he wanted people to know the feeling that he got when he was forgiven. And so he encouraged other people who were victims of persecution. He said, don't curse those who persecute you. Bless them instead. Pray for them. In fact, he said, pray that God will bless them. God will favor them. God will pour out his mercy towards them. Is that something you're willing to do tonight? Has somebody hurt you and you're thinking of ways to hurt them back? You're thinking of ways to avenge the pain that they've caused you. But maybe the Romans passage is telling you something otherwise. It's telling you to be more forgiving. It's telling you to not curse those who persecute you and hate you, but instead ask that God will bless them. Because when God blesses them, they will change. And when they change for real, then they will no longer persecute you. They will no longer be your enemy. So be willing to forgive, because God is willing to forgive. The second thing Paul says is, be happy for those who are happy and weep with those who weep. In other words, develop this spirit of empathy and sensitivity. You know, don't ridicule people when they go through hard times. Don't gloat over their misfortunes. When people are in pain, learn to feel their pain. And at the same time, when they are blessed, when they're happy, when they're favored, when God shows them grace and mercy, be happy for them, even if you don't like them. Even if you think they don't deserve it, because who deserves mercy and grace anyway? And when God chooses to be kind, and when God chooses to be merciful to even people who don't deserve it, then maybe we should be happy as well, because hasn't God done the same for us? And then the third thing Paul says is, live in harmony with each other. Learn to get along. Don't be too proud to enjoy the company of ordinary people. And don't think that you know it all. Who's Paul talking about here? The person who deals with pride, someone with a haughty spirit, someone who thinks that they're better than everyone else, someone who looks down on others for whatever reason, maybe because of their intellectual abilities, their ethnicity, the color of their skin, whatever it is that causes you to be a bigoted person. You know, Paul is saying, don't be like that. Instead, learn to live and get along with other people. That's part of being forgiving. Not just to say I forgive them, but don't ever let them come close to me. No, true forgiveness, as Luther said, learns to forget. To forget doesn't mean it leaves your memory. To forget means that you no longer let it affect the decisions and way of living from this point on. You leave it behind. You let bygones be bygones because you are after a better way towards a better future. Now, to follow this up, not only does Paul in Romans tell people what they should do and instruct them in the way they should go, but he also creates a path that leads to triumph for those that decide to follow his instructions. So in the same chapter, but going to verse 17 onward, he says the following. Number one, never pay back evil with more evil. Because that only makes the matter worse. When you fight fire with fire, you end up burning the house down. And that's just not wise. And it's not good for anyone, including yourself. Number two, Paul said, do things in such a way that everyone can see that you are honorable. So what that people are hateful? So what that people intend harm? Does that mean you should be like them? Aren't you a new creation in Christ Jesus? Shouldn't you be exhibiting a new and different kind of behavior? Aren't you supposed to be more honorable because you are now in Christ? Then show it. Don't do it just because they do it. Don't make it an excuse that, oh, if they hurt me, then I should hurt them back. Rather, if you are a new creation in Christ, shouldn't you be the type of person who says, yes, they hurt me. Yes, it was painful, but the cycle of hatred stops here. It begins with my forgiveness and my willingness to offer that to anyone that needs it. So the third thing Paul says is, do all that you can do to live in peace with everyone. Can you really live in peace with everyone? Maybe not, but you should still give it a shot. You should still try. You know, you can't help it that some people are just troublemakers and people are maybe planning your destruction or downfall. You can't help that. But what Paul is saying is, to the extent that it's up to you, to the extent that you have control, at least you should seek to live at peace with others. Don't be someone who causes trouble. Don't make enemies that you don't need to be making. Don't add fuel to fire that's already destroying too many lives. Instead, pursue peace, because doesn't one of the Beatitudes say, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children, sons and daughters of God. And finally, or fourthly, he says, never take revenge. Instead, what does Paul tell his readers? He says, vengeance belongs to the Lord. Let God take care of it. You can't be avenging every hurt done to you. You're just going to waste your life, you know, pursuing that which is painful and hurtful. Rather, you should pursue the life of love and forgiveness and grace and mercy, because that's what breeds that same amount of grace and overflow of mercy in the lives of other people. And then fifthly, he says, conquer evil by doing good. Right? You've all heard that phrase that I used earlier. Don't fight fire with fire, because you cause a bigger fire. How do you fight evil? You fight evil by doing good. How come? Because you have been made good by the grace and mercy of God. Remember the lesson we learned a couple of weeks ago, that we are saved by grace through faith, not of our works, so that none of us can boast. But once we are saved by the grace of God, we become God's masterpiece, who will then do good works as a reflection of the work of Jesus Christ in us. We're now the type of people who respond even to hatred with goodness. We challenge people to live up to a higher standard by being a model of that standard. I know this is a tough lesson to learn. It might take a few days, weeks for us to process it. But hopefully there's enough in the lesson tonight that you can put into practice. So let me offer to you a couple of words as we conclude. Number one, I think it's very important that you acknowledge the hurt not only that you have, but the hurt that you may have caused in the lives of other people. We are equally culpable for the pain that this world is enduring because we have contributed to much of that. Secondly, you and I should be grateful for Christ's grace and forgiveness. You know, the Bible says that he died for us, had mercy on us while we were yet sinners. Then shouldn't we return the favor or pay it forward, so to speak, by being more forgiving towards those who are still our enemies? And thirdly, how about we learn to extend forgiveness towards those who have hurt us, whether or not they ask for it or whether or not we think they deserve it, but because we ourselves have been forgiven, we are now in the best position to be forgiving. Well, that's our lesson for tonight, a lesson on forgiveness. There's many ways that we can put it to practice. Some of you need to be more forgiving and others need to accept forgiveness depending on what you're going through. But let me encourage you that however you choose to apply these principles, I think the blessings of God will continue to be poured into your life. So let me pray with you as we close, and then we'll take time to also learn to bless one another. Father, we thank you for our lesson tonight. We thank you for the difficult but much needed lesson on forgiveness. Thank you for forgiving us, and may it cause us to be more forgiving towards others, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So as we, and before we bring this to an end, I'd like to encourage you to take this time to consider giving an offering to Bridgepoint so that we can continue to bless others and do the work that we do. There's a slide on your screen that shows you how you can give online. And while we're preparing our offering, I'd like to invite my son, Jonathan, to come to lead us in a song of worship and to close us in prayer. John, would you come?
My supply, my breath of life. Still more awesome than I know. You are my reward, worth living for. Still more awesome than I know. None of you is more than enough for. All of me for every thirst and every need, you satisfy me with your love, and all I have in you is more than enough, more than all I want, more than all I need. More than enough for me, more than all I want, more than all I can see. You are more than enough, and all of you is more than enough for all of me, for every thirst and every need. You satisfy me with your love, and all I have in you is more than enough.
Amen. Thank you, Jonathan. We appreciate you and leading us in worship. Let me go ahead and lead us in a prayer for the offering and to close. Father, we thank you once again for our time together. We thank you for those who have given unto you, and may your blessings be upon these gifts. May it be used for your glory, for the work of your kingdom, and that anything we do will be for the knowledge of Jesus Christ, born in the hearts of people who listen to this and even beyond. We thank you for this evening and our time of study together in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. All right. Thank you very much for joining us. We appreciate the time that you spend listening and contemplating on the lesson. And this brings our Bible study to an end. As always, if you'd like to greet your brothers and sisters, especially those of you on Zoom, you can go ahead and turn on your microphones and your webcams. Let's greet one another as we close. God bless you. Thank you for joining us. And we'll see you this Sunday. And if you can't join us on Sunday, definitely we'll see you again next Wednesday.